In 2010, I was in the highly bizarre and, I thought, unprecedented position of doubting the identity of the man that I had been in an intimate relationship with for 6 years. Up until that point, I thought I'd met the man that I would be with for years and years. I thought I'd found a close friend, a political ally, a future, and you know, I had started, you know, we'd been planning that future, but it turned out that my partner was, in fact, the undercover, wasn't Mark Stone, who I thought he was actually the undercover cop, Mark Kennedy, who'd been leading a double life, my life. It turned out that the person I thought I'd been in a relationship was actually a fictional character that had been constructed between him and his employers, the Metropolitan Police, and he'd been sent in by those employers to spend time doing all the kind of things that I was doing. All the time that we were together, he was, you know, he was often being paid overtime for the things that he was doing. His employers had just placed him into my life, and unbeknownst to me, whilst I was busy making him one of the most central characters in that life, they had always planned one day to just pull him out at random without any warning. And that was something that I learned had happened to other people before me, but at that time, I didn't really know anything about that. The discovery that he was an undercover cop shattered my confidence in myself. My ability to form intimate relationships with others since then, my trust in my own ability to judge a character, and it removed me, possibly temporarily, we shall see, from the political activities that I'd been involved in at that time. In fact, the whole ground that I'd been stood on felt like it shifted and just tipped me completely upside down. And then the shockwaves of that event and the things that happened in that October are still with me. In fact, they're still something that I'm, you know, unable to kind of really put down. But it is something that has opened, that started a big chain of other events. Because it wasn't long after that devastating first discovery that I realised that other people had been in a similar position to me. And I thought that what had happened to me was so unlikely and so incredible that it couldn't possibly have happened to anyone else, otherwise I would have heard about it. I'd always heard about undercover police in protest movements. That's not something that was particularly alien. And you always imagine that demos that you go on have maybe got police in them, or you can even, you know, play spot the undercover cop, or meetings that you've been in. We used to do this whole ritual around security of taking batteries out of mobile phones before going into meetings, and not realizing that actually the person who I was handing my phone over to, you know, to put in his pocket while we were in the meeting was actually the undercover cop. So when I discovered that actually the person who'd been the closest person in my life was actually that undercover cop, I thought it was something so incredible and so unbelievable that this couldn't possibly have happened to anyone else. And then slowly I started to meet other people that it had happened to. And not long after the first devastating revelations, I got a letter from Helen Steele saying, you know, if you ever want to talk, something similar has happened to me. And at that time, I was like, surely not, no, that can't be possible. And then eventually kind of realizing and meeting other people, realizing that it wasn't that I'd been stupid. It wasn't that I'd been, you know, that I'd been duped, or that there'd been loads of signals that I hadn't spotted. There'd been loads of things that, you know, maybe I could have done differently. You then realise, meeting some of the other women involved in the case that this has happened to over the years, that actually this wasn't just something that happened to me. This was an ongoing tactic. This was a strategy. This was just the way the Met operated. And whilst that's a very depressing thing to find out, it's also quite encouraging, because it made me realise that actually I didn't really have a chance. You know, I thought initially that, you know, I should have known. I felt stupid. I should have been able to tell. There should have been signs. But actually, you realise that what I was facing was an ongoing strategy, a tactic that was backed up by infrastructure, by supervisors, and that other people had been duped in the same way. Right. so I got a bit carried away, lost my train. Yeah. I guess what I realised was different about what happened to me, or the slight, you know, everybody, the way it's happened with a lot of other people who've spoke at these meetings, everybody's story has got unique characteristics or things that are different about what happened to them. And I guess the bit that's slightly different with my story is the fact that I discovered his identity, that he was an undercover cop, whilst he was still around. And I actually had the chance to confront him about it and have him admit it to my face, which is what ended up with us having the proof that then led to kind of a much wider acceptance of what had happened, and kind of almost blowing open these kind of closed doors, and everything that had happened in secrecy. You know, suddenly we could shine a big light into that hole and if not see everything that was going on, but just at least force the Met to acknowledge it and to give us some answers. And the one thing that I, you know, the thing that I mostly take from that experience is that, you know, I really hope that maybe, just maybe, one day my experiences and the experiences of others could stop something similar happening to someone else, or at least if someone else does find themselves in the position that I found myself in that autumn, that they will know that there's a precedent for this. This has happened before. They'll be believed, and hopefully they'll know that there's a framework in which they can challenge what happened to them. I guess I should tell a bit more about the story. I don't know how many of you already know my story, but I guess I'll start by saying that the first inkling that I had that there was anything wrong with him, or anything unusual about his behaviour, was after we'd been together for about 5.5 years, and that was in 2009. And the first thing that I noticed was his odd behaviour. And his odd behaviour I now know to be part of the kind of tried and tested Met Police exit strategy. But anyway, going back a bit further than that, we first got together in the end of 2004 on a climbing holiday. It was an idealistic part of my life that he entered. I'd spent quite a lot of time being involved in lots of different campaigns, from environmentalism, the anti-roads movement, campaigns against GM crops, also quite a lot of social justice campaigns, things about deportation, things about detention centres, anti-fascist stuff in the local area where I lived at that time. And I thought I met somebody who shared my values, who shared my views. We had a lot of politics in common, I thought. But also, it wasn't just about politics. We started spending a lot of time together doing all kinds of things that were not political. And that's the thing, the amount of time I spent with him doing politics was really minimal compared to the amount of time we spent just spending time, in the same way that anybody spends time with somebody in a relationship. It was very domestic. We had hobbies in common. We used to go climbing. He was somebody who would come on adventures with me. He liked a lot of the same things that I did. He liked a lot of the same music. He got really involved in my family. From playing with my nieces and nephews with me, to coming to my father's funeral with me, to being the person that supported me after my father died, one of the people who would listen to me when I was upset, somebody that I ended up sharing quite a lot of my hopes and dreams with, and my ideas for what I would do in the future. You know, when you're with somebody and you've got a partner, you end up sort of, you know, discussing, oh, what, you know, what's this new job I'm going to take, or this course I want to do, or am I going to move house here, am I going to move there? You end up, you know, you discuss all of that over with your partner, and you grow and change alongside somebody you're with. So one of the big things about when I found out that he wasn't who I thought he'd been, it wasn't just that then I didn't know who he was, it's that I didn't really know who I was anymore. I'd grown and changed over that time with somebody who was fictional. And, you know, if they were fictional, then what did that make me now? So that was quite a big kind of realization. And the slow realizing that he wasn't who he thought he was really quite a difficult time. And that's actually the hardest time to talk about, the time in which I wasn't quite sure of his identity. It feels like kind of allowing me to find out in that way was another form of psychological torture, really. So I'm losing my thread a bit again, but I'll get it back. Yeah, so I suppose I should, again, go back to the story. Maybe that's what I'll do. So, how it happened. So I mentioned before the exit strategy. So I'd found out from some of the other women, a bit too hot. So after meeting other women who had had relationships with undercover cops and starting the legal case that we started, we ended up sharing our stories. Found quite a lot of real startling similarities in those stories. And one of those similarities being the way that those officers who'd really kind of involved themselves in the most personal aspects of people's lives, the way they left was quite particularly cruel, I think. So the standard way to leave generally would be to fake some kind of emotional breakdown. And I'll still never know, to this day, in 2009, when I was desperately worried about his state of mind, how much of that was real and how much of it was put on. I believe that it was both real and put on. I think it definitely was their exit strategy. That's what they all did. Fake an emotional breakdown or have some kind of emotional breakdown and then vanish. And that was their MO. I also think that at that time Mark was completely coming apart, and so I don't think it was a difficult thing to put on in order to leave. So he had this breakdown, I was desperately worried about him, and then he vanished. And it's that vanishing that's what then leads the people who are left behind to need to look after them, to need to look for them. And I think it's, you know, it's that vanishing act that shows how the Met ultimately totally underestimated the women involved in these stories. They totally underestimated the fact that if you get really, really close to somebody and then you have a breakdown, you vanish, that person is going to be desperately worried and is going to be searching and is going to be looking. And Mark did that. He did that vanishing act, and I was desperately worried about him, and I was constantly in contact with him. And what he did differently was basically he didn't do the vanishing act that he was supposed to do. But that was definitely the point at which I now know his police operation ended, and he was supposed to have left, but he didn't. And I think maybe, you know, as everybody gets a little bit more technologically connected, it's much harder to do a vanishing act in that way these days, because everyone expects texts and phone calls and photographs and, you know, emails, all of that kind of thing. So anyway, he ended up coming back. He returned, but he wasn't the same. He was very different, and I think he was different for a couple of reasons. Partly he had actually partly lost his mind, and he didn't really know what he was doing. He'd lost the support of the Metropolitan Police, so he no longer had his fake passport, he no longer had his fake driving license, and things like that. And so it turned out that I ended up finding his passport, his real passport, in a glove box. And that's the point at which things really changed, and I started to have doubts about his identity. But it wasn't just that he had a different name. Now that to me didn't seem that unusual. I know there could be many simple explanations for why somebody has a different name to their legal given name. It might be a bit odd that they've not mentioned it, but it's not totally out of the ordinary. What was unusual about it was that his passport mentioned that he had a child. And the character I knew, the Mark Stone that I knew, would never have had a child. He was, you know, he came across as this kind of independent, free spirit. And to find out that somebody you'd been in a relationship with for 6 years has children that they hadn't mentioned, you know, that's kind of a big deal. And it was that kind of made the world, you know, my world shift from then on. And then I was in this kind of weird limbo for a while, where he'd given me an explanation that I sort of believed, but cracks kept appearing in it. And I was leading this, I got this kind of weird inclination of what being in a double life, what leading a double life might be like. because I was kind of half doubting him and half believing him, and you know, fluctuating desperately between the two. And I know that I've been longer than my time, but I'll just get to the end of that bit of the story. There may be quite a lot more questions. But yeah, so cracks started appearing in his story, and he started changing his story and all kinds of things. And then it was just a random coincidence in some ways, but I ended up just going around to a friend's house who was doing research into genealogy for a whole totally unrelated reason. And I asked him, can you look at Mark Stone on this, you know, can we just, and they kind of looked at me a bit odd, but we did it and nothing came back. And then my research, we did some more research, and that's the kind of period of research that happened. But because of a combination of factors, that period didn't take very long. What took others years and years to find out the truth, because of the more modern age of computerized records and everything being searchable online, it was actually not that difficult to find out the information. And the other key bits of information that I had were from that passport discovery, which was the names of his children and his name. It turns out he'd used the same date of birth. So it wasn't too long before we had what seemed almost unarguable, but it was just like, this is still, being an undercover cop is still the least plausible explanation. You know, some of the things that he'd said about, you know, that he'd been somebody, he was a drug dealer, or, you know, those kind of things seemed so much more likely, knowing him, or knowing the character that he presented. So eventually, you know, the only way to move forward from it was to ask him to answer for himself. And that's something that he did. It turned out that not only did he have two kids, but he had a wife who he was still married to, and two children, and he was still living with them. And the whole time he'd been with me, every couple of weeks when I thought he was going away for work, he was actually going back to see his family. And that's again something else that, whilst it was shocking to me at the time, is not unique to me either. It turns out that all the police in that unit operating in that way had to be married to get the job, because their employers thought that gave them something to get to come home for. So yeah, just to finish up, I don't think I'm ever going to know the answer to lots and lots of the questions that I've got about what happened in that time, about what happened to me. And the fact that those questions are constantly circulating in my head, why was I targeted? Was I targeted in particular? Was it just a coincidence? Was it just that we had a connection and that he exploited that? Who else was listening to our communications for all those years? Who were the backroom faces of supervisors, of handlers, of people who monitored his phone, people who monitored his email? Did anyone come along with us on the holidays that we went on, the many times where it was just us? Was there actually somebody else listening into that? I'm never going to know the answer to those questions. And I think because of that, it's a bit like when you wake up in the morning and you hear half a song on the radio and it doesn't quite finish. And then for the rest of the day, you've got that song stuck in your head because your brain is kind of trying to fill in the gaps. It's trying to finish it. It sort of feels like that, but magnified. And every time a little piece of the story and a little bit slots into place, it feels like, you know, I've heard a little bit more of that song and I'm a bit closer to being able to put it down, but there's just, you know, it's just the very beginning of being able to find out a fraction of those answers. And I think that, you know, I think that I've had to come to terms with the fact that I'm actually never going to hear the full song. And thanks to things that other people on this panel, other people in this room, other people have spoken at previous meetings, and the fight that's going on to expose all the injustices that have happened now, you know, that hopefully we'll get a bit closer. But yeah, just to say that I feel like the way that the Met have systematically treated women, the women that they disregarded, who they never believed would search for their partners, who've ended up blowing this whole thing open. The women who, you know, who were married to those cops, whose families were kind of disregarded and not played a part. You know, it's that abuse of women, that degradation of women, that institutionalized sexist attitudes of the Met are something that's definitely got to change. I think I've got loads more to say, but I've come to the end of my time. So. Thank you. I just wanted to say something that I did forget to say that I definitely wanted to say is explain why anonymity, because a few people have asked me that tonight. Why am I anonymous? Why do I have a court case, a court order preserving my anonymity? And just to say that when you've had every single aspect of your most intimate personal life, which you thought was private, you suddenly realise that was not as private as you thought, that that's actually been quite public, probably in some canteens and locker rooms sort of up and down the city. And then having had, after all the revelations first came out, to be slightly hounded by the media to find my identity, you know, the Sunday Sport were offering £1,000 to anybody to come forward to say that they'd slept with an undercover policeman when it first came out. In the context of all of that, I decided that I wanted to rebuild my life without having all of this follow me everywhere that I go. It follows me in my head, but just for it not to follow me into my life. And I just thought I'd mention that because I just wanted to explain that's why I don't want my face tweeted or my name talked about. And, you know, sometimes it feels like a self-imposed gagging order, so I feel really pleased that I've been able to speak here in front of a big room of people and actually get my story out there in my words and not in other people's words. So it's a hard balance that I'm trying to strike, and I hope you'll bear with me on that.